Hi, Dr. Silverstein. Thank you for seeing me today. I've been feeling kind of dizzy and I have some hearing loss. And I was wondering if you think I might have Meniere's disease.
Well, it's very possible that you could have Meniere's disease, but there are other problems that you could have also. So we need to do a complete history on you and do a hearing test and evaluate you and see what the diagnosis is.
Are there different types of symptom combinations that can be considered Meniere's disease?
Yes, symptoms, actually Meniere's disease has three types. The classical type, where you have recurrent episodes of vertigo that last from anywhere from 30 minutes to several hours. You have fluctuating hearing loss in one ear. You have tinnitus and ringing in the ear and fullness in the ear. And these attacks come and go, and they can be come every once in a while. They can come every day or every week or every month. So that's called the classical Meniere's disease. The second type is the cochlear type of Meniere's disease, where you just have the fluctuating hearing loss, the pressure and fullness in the ear, you do not have any vertigo. And those symptoms can occur, and then eventually you could get attacks of vertigo later on. Now, the third type is what we call vestibular Meniere's disease, or recurrent episodes of vertigo, where you're sick and you have nausea and vomiting, and these occur again from about 30 minutes to 2 hours or longer, and they occur at various times, but there is no hearing loss and there's no pressure and fullness in the ear.
How is Meniere's disease diagnosed?
So the way we diagnose Meniere's disease is usually by taking a good history. About 90% of the patients, we can make the diagnosis just from taking the history and talking to the patient. But then we confirm the diagnosis by doing hearing tests, a balance test where we have you stand on a platform, what we call a caloric test or a stimulation of the inner ear, or we call it a VNG. And that tells us the activity of the inner ear and how much damage the Meniere's disease has caused to the balance system. We do also do a pressure test on the inner ear where we can determine whether there's pressure in the inner ear, and that's usually the cause of Meniere's disease.
So once you determine that I have Meniere's disease, say these tests come back positive, how is Meniere's disease treated? What will we do next?
Well, we'd like to do allergy workup on you with skin tests, because 50% of the patients with Meniere's disease have allergies that they don't know about. And treating their allergies helps the dizziness and their hearing loss. The first thing that we do after we do that is to put the patient on a low-salt diet and with a diuretic. The diuretic that we like to use is called Diamox or acetazolamide. And that helps reduce the pressure and fullness in the inner ear. The next thing we use is lorazepam, which is Ativan. That is a small pill that we can place under the tongue. And it takes just a few minutes to be absorbed into the body, and it will help stop the vertigo attack if it starts to occur. You just put a pill under your tongue, and that'll help you greatly. So that's how we treat when their patients are having vertigo attacks. Now to treat the fullness and stuffiness in the ear, many times we can give the patients steroids, either by mouth or placing it into the ear directly. And I invented a device that allows the patient to put drops in their ear for a month of steroids. And these drops, the device is called a microwick, and the drops are placed in the ear 3 times a day by the patient, and the steroids go directly into the inner ear. When you take it by mouth, it goes through the bloodstream, and not as much steroids get into the inner ear. So to treat it more effectively, we place the drops in the ear, and we can treat the patient for a long period of time, say a month. Some doctors just inject steroids through the eardrum into the inner ear, but these steroids have a chance to leave the middle ear very quickly down the eustachian tube, and the patients really don't get long-term treatment with the steroids by just injecting it. Now, if the patient still continues to have vertigo attacks, we then switch to another drug called Gentamicin that we inject right into the through the eardrum. And this drug will kill the balance cells of the inner ear and stop the vertigo attacks of Meniere's. If this doesn't, in some patients, the inner ear is resistant to the Gentamicin and the steroids, then we have to revert to more serious surgery, where if the patient's hearing is very poor in the ear, we can do what we call labyrinthectomy, and we go into the ear right through the ear canal, and we can destroy the inner ear, but we lose the hearing in the ear, and the patient will have some imbalance after the procedure, but they'll be cured of the Meniere's disease. And this is how we treated patients with Meniere's disease in the old days. We would just do a labyrinthectomy on them, and they would be done, finished with their problem. With the technology that we have today, even though we destroy the hearing in the ear, the patient can be allowed to hear out of the ear with a cross or bicross type of hearing aid. And sometimes they can be have a cochlear implant inserted also into this ear. If the hearing is good, then we like to do a procedure called the vestibular neurectomy, a procedure that I developed in the 70s. We've done 250 of these operations. We rarely do them today, because the Gentamicin and the steroids seem to control the symptoms of the patients, and they don't need to have the big surgery to cut the balance nerve. By cutting the balance nerve, it stops the vertigo attacks from the patient, and they still have their hearing because we preserve the cochlear nerve and the facial nerve. You don't have to live with vertigo anymore. I mean, patients with Meniere's disease are told they have to live with it. Well, they don't have to live with it. We have various treatments, and it's usually a long-term treatment with the patient. Sometimes if we catch the patients real early in the disease, which is called subclinical high drops or subclinical Meniere's disease, and put steroids in their ear early, we can abort the attacks of Meniere's disease in the future. In these patients, which is the what we call the subclinical high drops, all they have in their ear is pressure and fullness in the ear, and we can find no other cause for it. And we presume that it's due to the Meniere's starting in the ear. And if you treat the patient with steroids intratympanically, put the microwick in, then 75-80% of the patients will have relief of their vertigo, relief of their stuffiness and fullness in their ear, and that may abort their Meniere's disease for the future.
Great, thank you so much. I think you've answered all my questions. I'm ready to get some testing and get treated for Meniere's disease.